you've probably heard about this new book. We have discussed it actually a number of times on the program. It's pretty interesting, and it's called Amateur Hour. It's about Vice President Kamala Harris and what the Bidens think of her. It's not good how she has struggled in the early years as vice president. All the word salads, which we'll play here in a second. Massive staff exodus. Nobody wants to work with her. Okay, she's the border czar, unless you believe Katie Kirk, who said, well, you're not in charge of the border, which was asinine. Yes, if you're the border czar. By the way, maybe she should make a real trip down to the border and see with their own eyes now that they want this showdown with Texas. Anyway, the multiple reboots of her vice presidency, the real relationship with the Biden family behind the scenes. She is not liked by either Joe or Jill Biden, according to this book. We have a detailed history of Harris's long competitive history with Gavin Newsom and what that how that might play out in the future. She was not Joe Biden's first choice. The first choice apparently was Governor Whitmer of Michigan. Anyway, there's a lot to talk about here, but you know, just a quick reminder of how bizarre her speaking patterns are. And I don't know why I always walk away with the feeling after hearing her like I just sat through kindergarten class.
Together, we are expanding access to transportation. Seems like maybe it's a small issue. It's a big issue. You need to get to go and need to be able to get where you need to go to do the work and get home.
So I'm here to ask you to do what you know how to do, because when you do what you do on all of these issues, the American people win.
Talking about the significance of the passage of time, right? The significance of the passage of time. So when you think about it, there is great significance to the passage of time.
More parents are seeing the value of educators when they had to bring their kids and say, we're not paying them nearly enough.
It is time for us to do what we have been doing, and that time is every day. Every day it is time for us to agree.
Now, when we talk about our children, I know for this group, we all believe that when we talk about the children of the community, they are the children of the community.
You got to take this stuff seriously as you are, because you have been forced to have to take it seriously.
I mean, you just can't make any of this stuff up. Anyway, the author of this soon-to-be bestseller, Amateur Hour, talking about Kamala Harris is... Charlie Spiering is back with us. Sir, first of all, congratulations on the book. A lot of sourcing in here. How were you able to get this story that they pretty much have kept under wraps for 3 years, that the Bidens really can't stand her?
Hi, Sean. Yeah, it's something that Democrats don't really want to talk about in public, because the moment they start criticizing this historic first woman, first black vice president, they'll be immediately branded as sexist and racist. But behind the scenes in Washington, it's true. Very few Democrats even like her, let alone feel like defending her.
But you go into detail. Biden knows full well that she's not up to the job of commander-in-chief. Apparently, his preference was Gretchen Whitmer, and that didn't happen. He chose Harris. Why?
Well, he was definitely pressured by former President Obama to pick a woman of color on the ticket. You know, he famously promised to pick a woman on the ticket. He liked Whitmer. He liked her populist style, her plain-spoken Midwest accent. Would help him win the state of Michigan. But senior advisors soon realized during the summer of rage, during the George Floyd riots, that they really needed a black woman on the ticket to sort of help Joe through this election and help him not alienate all the black voters who were really upset by some of his... So they
played identity politics with the person that actually, you know, tweeted out the bail fund after the precinct in Minneapolis was burned to the ground, that same vice president. That sounds like she's supporting insurrection to me.
Absolutely. Yeah, it was a mess. And so they really thought if they just brought on a woman of color on the ticket, they could reassemble the Obama coalition. And after Biden's horrific gaffes on poor kids, they're just smart as white kids, after he said you're not black if you vote for Trump, the black community was very upset by that, and they tried to find somebody who could help them through the election.
She was the only Democrat in the primary that actually brought up the issue that I have pointed out many times, and that was Joe Biden partnering with a former Klansman by the name of Robert Byrd to stop the integration of public schools, saying that he did not want public schools to become, his words, a racial jungle. She was the only one that pointed it out, but then gladly grabbed the vice presidency when offered. What is the state of, what are Joe and Jill Biden thinking about her now? Well, let's ask that question.
Joe's certainly disappointed. He kind of wanted a buddy, a true partner he could work with in the White House, the way he felt about Barack Obama. But it turns out that Kamala Harris is not really interested in playing buddy with Joe Biden. She's in there to protect her brand, to protect her political future. She's thankful to Joe. Thanks for bringing me up and putting me in this vice presidential slot. But she's not that interested in taking on some of the toughest issues that he needs help with, and not interested in sort of just watching him dwindle with her being in the same place. So she's trying to pull out and protect her brand, and certainly the Bidens don't see her as very competent or loyal.
All right, let's ask this question, and it's not beyond the pale that at some point between now and next November, Joe Biden announces he's not able to continue, or maybe worse. I hope not. I don't wish that on anybody. And if that moment comes, you talk about this contentious relationship that she's had with Gavin Newsom. Now, I interviewed Gavin Newsom, and I moderated a debate between him and Governor DeSantis. And he could not have been more clear in both instances that he believes the next person up would be Kamala Harris if, in fact, he, Joe Biden, was unable to run or even finish his term, but unable to run in the next election if he bails out. Now, we keep hearing Gavin Newsom's name, and we keep hearing Michelle Obama's name. What are you hearing?
Yeah, why is Gavin Newsom in South Carolina right now? Why is he on the campaign trail? Oh, I'm doing it for Joe, but no. Very clear. He's
doing it because Joe can't talk. Joe can't get through a single event. Yesterday's event in Wisconsin was an unmitigated disaster. And so that's the reason. But he keeps, he is steadfast in him saying under no circumstances will he run. That doesn't mean he won't. It just, that's what he was saying. He said it convincingly, and he said it often to me and to Governor DeSantis.
Oh, it's Democrats' biggest fear. If Joe Biden can't make it to Election Day, that'll trigger an automatic frenzy among Democrat donors and Democrats all around, because they know that Kamala Harris is not up for the job to compete with Trump in a general election.
So how will that go over with a big part of the Democratic base that is suburban moms and African Americans? How's that going to go over?
That's the difficult part. It'll be very hard to oust Kamala Harris without angering a significant portion of his base. This is what happens when you play identity politics. It can snap you right back in the face. And so, look, there's going to be an open competition if Joe Biden can't make it to Election Day. Their biggest hope is that Joe Biden can make it across the finish line, pass the election. That's why he had to run for re-election, because Kamala wasn't ready. He would have been more than happy to pass the baton if he felt that Kamala could compete with Trump. But that's obviously not the case, and that's why Democrats are in that position today.
Pretty amazing times we're living in, I got to tell you. But, yeah, I think amateur hour, her in the White House has not been a good run for her in any way. She thinks that the reason that their poll numbers are so low and that Donald Trump is beating them by 6 points in a poll out today and 7 in a poll out yesterday or earlier in the week, it's because they're not touting their accomplishments enough. Do you believe that that's the case? Because I don't.
Yeah, they just don't have anything right to say. That all they have to say, they're selling this script of fear, right? She went on The View and said, I'm terrified of Donald Trump. I'm terrified of what he'll do to our country. We got to run scared. Everyone should be scared of the evil MAGA movement. They're all going to destroy you and ruin your lives. That's kind of the message they're running on. They can't run on the idea that, say, hey, we have a plan to bring down inflation. Hey, we're going to boost the economy. And instead, they just have anti-economic policies that are actually destroying the economy. And people every day are struggling with inflation, and they still don't have a message on how they're going to fix it.
Well, we wish you a lot of luck with the book. We really appreciate your time, Charlie Spiering. The book is called Amateur Hour, Kamala Harris in the White House. It's going to get interesting. Let's see if he makes it through the convention. At that point, I'd say they're pretty well locked in as long as he, can make it to November. But we appreciate it. Thank you, sir.